consensus in the management of hypertension. You see, the management of hypertension has been changing throughout the decades, and people are getting more and more knowledgeable. The target of hypertension has been shifting. It is that at some place of time, people say that you have to go as low as possible. Some say that when you try to go low, the danger and the risk is more. Now, if you remember the early days when it was said that the Chinese people had first discovered that hypertension was something which was an entity, and suddenly that was more common in fact, and the lean patients such as paralysis and apoplexy would occur, and this is what Hippocrates had said. Now, the first person to measure blood pressure was Hales. In fact, what he did was that he put the direct cannula into the blood vessel and used to do it. But later on, this gentleman, Rivarotti, started thinking and invented the sphygmomanometer, which we currently use. And based on the sphygmomanometer, a lot of researches have been done, but it was ultimately a non-invasive method by which the second trial was given, and moreover, the patients became comfortable. Being a third world country, hypertension is something which you see has one of the major complications, major diseases, and over the previous years, from 1942 onwards, you can see that there has been a steady rise of hypertension in India. Whether you take the urban population or the rural population, as you see, the rural population are not exempt from hypertension, except the fact that they are neglected in their field. So hypertension is a disease, what we call as a silent killer, and in fact, 1 in 4 patients, 1 in 4 individuals in our country presently are hypertensives. Now what we see in clinical practice is just the tip of the iceberg. What we see is a lot below, which you do not know, in the patient either lands up with a non-renal failure, a congestive failure, or a coronary disease, or an ophthalmological problem, or a CV. Now, when we think of consensus, it always reminds us that it is not a one-person show. We can never have a consensus when there is a single person who is giving his ideas. It is always that there should be a group involved to give a consensus. For this, there has been a lot of divide, geographical divide, and it has been in 1977 that first the report in Journal of the American Medical Association appeared, where they gave the consensus initial guidelines. Then over the years, 1980, 84, 88, till JNC 5 came in 1993. Then the JNC 6 came in 97, and the JNC 7 in 2003. From 2003 onwards, there was a long gap till 2014, when the guidelines came. But this was more of a report rather than a guideline, because there had been a lot of controversies, and there was hardly consensus about certain subjects. So people started thinking whether one should follow this or they should have their own guidelines from their own country. Now, if you try to see how many of the people follow the guidelines, because the guidelines are not individual centric, are not specific for a particular patient, but these are broad guidelines that has been followed. And based on recent studies that have taken place, I tell that the next guidelines are possibly required a massive change. Now, JNC 8 came in 2014 with the last guidelines, and as usual, we follow the Americans a lot because we think them that they are big brothers. What is basically covered in these guidelines is 3 aspects. First, they discuss the age-based recommendation, a little less stringent. Next, they try to target for patients with chronic kidney disease and diabetes. These are 2 issues that were picked up. So these are the most vulnerable patients to multiple organ damage and early mortality. And lastly, the pharmacotherapy started having a wider latitude. Previously, they had a concept that first you start with drug E, then drug B, then B, then C, like this. But diabetics is to take the upper hand. But nowadays, they have given a very wider choices so that drugs can be easily covered up. Now, if you ask me what are the controversies regarding hypertension, first question that comes, is this patient a hypertensive? That means, whether whatever the age group is, can there be an absolute number, that is, supposing it is 140, 90, then it is hypertension. Now next comes when to initiate treatment. Because whatever we do is an OPD practice in which we do not follow up the patient doesn't come, and most of the time they change the physician, so you have to be very sure about when to initiate the treatment. Once we initiate treatment, we should know what are our targets. That is what the patient should achieve. And a very burning topic is, what about the elderly population? People say that if it is more than 160-90, it is okay. But somehow change, concepts have changed, and consensus will come that older, the elderly people have also to be taken at least as the younger people. About diuretics and beta blockers, there has been a lot of stands from, and gradually the issue is settling down. The uptitration of drugs, because there has been inertia from the physicians regarding increasing the drugs. Most important, after the sprint and the accord trial, a lot of stress has been given on the measurement of blood pressure. Are you doing it right? Because most of the patients you see, they come to the OPD, maybe they're standing and you're seeing the blood pressure, but the heart is set for a minute to see the blood pressure and whether it's right or not. One has to discuss. How important is non-pharmacological treatment in hypertension? This is very important because this is an aspect which we do not mainly stress on and directly go to drug therapy. Lastly, how to improve compliance is very important. Now, if you try to see the JNCs, what I have evaluated, means what I evolved over the years, first is to just describe something as the isolated systolic hypertension and borderline hypertension. Then gradually a little bit of our normal hypertension came in JNC4. And then they started staging into stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, keeping a high normal group. This was followed up by the stage 4 was abolished in JNC 6, and JNC 7 brought only a pre-hypertension stage, a stage 1 and stage 2, simplifying things. Now what was considered as optimal in the JNC 5, JNC 6 over the years became normal. So even today, if a patient comes with 140 by 90 blood pressure, do not consider him as a hypertension. In fact, it is optimal. Now, similarly, diastolic blood pressure has also been a moving target. So these targets have been moving from guidelines to guidelines. But as you stand today, you see the 2014 guidelines, they usually say that you can keep the normal individual who is less than 60 years at 150 by 90. Who is less than 60 years, you try to keep it by 140-90. But if the patient has a CKD, try also to keep it 149, but if there is proteinuria, try to bring it down to 130 by 70. Now the European guidelines also follow the similar, excepting that we see 2 points of difference, that is CKD no proteinuria 149, CKD with proteinuria 130-90. But in fact, if we try to see the JNC6, they have stressed that these are the patients who have to be targeted aggressively. The CHEST 2013 guidelines also follow the same principle. AHA tries to bring down the diabetic individuals to 140 AD. The KDIGO, the Kidney Society in diabetes, they also have also brought up to 130 AD. The NICE guidelines in the US also hovers around 140 to 90. And the ISHID guidelines in 2010 follows almost similar. So some 130 80 to 140 90 should be the idea. It is to retain home the message that if the patient is a diabetic or has renal disease, try to 130 by 80 or renal disease. Now the JNC8 or something is simplified very much, in which they just described into two groups. Either there are comorbidities or there are no comorbidities. If there are no comorbidities, so the age is less than 60 or less than more than 60, then definitely you have to have a particular protocol to start drugs. And if it is a diabetic or a CKD, also you can choose an AC inhibitor or an ARB as the first line of therapy. The Indian guidelines almost has passed through 3 stages, and as we stand today, the Indian guidelines 3 has been done. 2 important points that they have pointed out is the mercury sphygmomanometers have to be sorted out, have to be taken to the off the shelf, and we have to type digital sphygmomanometers. In US now, they are hardly following the mercury sphygmomanometers, and possibly by 2017 end, or early mid-2017, no mercury manometers will be available in the country. They have promoted in a way that home monitoring blood pressure, similar to the concept of home monitoring of blood sugars, so the more important, and that epidemiological data clearly says that increasing prevalence and poor levels of control throughout the country. Now, if you try to see the office mirror blood pressure, this is hardly has changed over the years. And as the guru of hypertension, Norman Kaplan said, the measurement of blood pressure is likely a clinical procedure of greatest importance that is performed in the most obvious manner. Many times we do not measure it ourselves. We ask our colleagues or our sister or a brother to do it, or a pharmacist, and they are very educated about how the blood pressure has to be taken. A simple monitoring manometer is still in use now that the LED instruments have come. But if you see, most importantly, you have to first find out what is the cuff that you are using, number one. And second, does the cuff cover the real area that you has to be covered? The cuff can be put in different shapes, different sizes. So basically, an adult cuff has to have a 16 and 20 centimeter size of a bladder and the arm circumference to 27 to 34. If it is an obese person or it is a pediatric person, try to choose the appropriate cuff. So it is recommended that each physician should have at least 3 cuffs with them, the adult cuff, the pediatric cuff, and the obese one. So, and the recommendations are really given. Now that we are very well conversant with the chordal cuff sounds that are the first one in response to the system and the disappearance or when it peoples down either the dashboard. And nowadays the British Hypertension Society has clearly enlisted several instruments which are to be used, and these are the instruments which have come to the British clinics, and the mercury parameters have taken a back stage. Certain guidelines is that we have to take 3 readings at 2-3 minutes interval. As usual, patients should not be drinking tea, coffee, or exercise for the last 30 minutes. Ask the patient to sit down for 5 minutes. It should be both sitting and supine position. Patient's arm should be at the level of the heart as the instrument. And measure blood pressure in both the arms. This is very important. In fact, people have suggested that measure blood pressure in 3 arms, the left arm, the right arm, and one limb. And whichever is the highest, you take that as reading. But if you follow these guidelines, then definitely you will be spending almost half an hour with each patient. And possibly where your clinic will end up by only seeing 10 patients. The next concept came of ambulatory blood pressure monitoring, in which is very simple to wear, and especially for patients who are uncontrolled. The 24-hour average was seen, and this, most importantly, ambulatory blood pressure monitoring correlates very closely with hypertension organ damage, and it changes by patient that does office blood pressure measurement. If you see that the patient is well controlled in the office, but somehow is developing certain complications of hypertension, put this patient on ambulatory blood pressure monitoring, and then you can identify patients who is not diseased at night time, that is non-pulmonary. These are the patients who have the highest cardiac mortality. If you can identify a patient who is a non-dipper, you have to be very careful in them to see that cardiac mortality is avoided. Now, in most of conditions where ambulatory blood pressure should be done, like borderline hypertension, white coat, as you know, systolic hypertension, especially in the resistant hypertension cases, in pregnancy, and if the patient tells that the blood pressure is normal in my clinic, but as he goes home, they see that it's a hypotension. Now, then came the concept of hypertension paradox. Now, what is this hypertension paradox? We have so many good drugs to control, we have so many good investigations to diagnose, everything is okay, but still the blood pressure is not controlled. This specifically was labeled as a hypertension paradox, in which it was basically because hypertension is silent disease, the patient does not complain anything, the therapy that are given are inadequate, the physician inertia is there, so that they do not try to apply different drugs. One concept that controls is that how much of salt has to be taken when you come to drugs. People say that for our country, especially possibly, we have to give at least restrict the salt, because this pure study has clearly shown the JCP and so that if the salt intake is 4 to 6 grams, then this is the area where it is most ideal for the patient to maintain normal tension. But the problem is that India being a tropical country, we cannot restrict the salt to too much an extent, because the elderly people are more prone to hyponatremia, and that is what is here in practice. Another area of controversy is the alcohol consumption. Does alcohol consumption increase blood pressure? It does. So there is a J-separate relationship also. And so it is recommended that one should try to reduce the alcohol intake for especially patients with hypertension. The new concept that we stand today is if a patient is high risk, you always start drugs and initial the lifestyle modification. If the patient is a moderate risk, start the lifestyle modification along with drugs. And if it's low risk, just try to keep on lifestyle modification. This is a little bit of a suggested slide, but basically it tries to say that whatever you see in the red are the areas where drug has been started as the initial factor. Whatever you see in the orange is something where you can give lifestyle modification and drugs, but the yellow and the green groups are basically for the lifestyle modification. Now the question is, how low can we go? The main thing we say that lipids try to keep as low as possible. Everything we try to keep low. The concept is that if you go low, the target organ damage is less. But is it true? Hypertension treatment when it started, it was said that if you try to go lower down, definitely you prevent stroke, coronary artery disease, heart failure, death, and overall this thing death. So definitely keeping the blood pressure low is welcome. But a JCP relationship does exist, that if you try to lower it down to a particular level, then you see that they are more prone for complications. There was at least 6 studies that showed that the JCP relationship does exist, but there was a study like the HOT study, Accord, ARC and the PROGRESS, which clearly stated that there is no JCP curve. But in fact, the recent trials of SPRINT has focused that the JCP and try to go lower on the blood pressures. To try to analyze that whether a drug really works, what she points, different classes of hypertension have different drugs risk reduction. This is you see the various groups. Whatever be the drug, they have definitely do some risk reduction. Atenolol was a drug which is thrown out of the basket because it has shown no mortality benefit. AC inhibitors, CCBs, diuretics and beta blockers compared to placebo, that's from all good results. And if you either use an AC inhibitor or the ARB, the benefit is definitely the maximum. Now, if you try to compare all the recent guidelines of JNCT, the European guidelines, AHA, the American Society of Hypertension, only the European Society states that you can start a beta blocker as first line therapy. The Americans have thrown in that beta blockers should not be the first medicine. Secondly, if the blood pressure is more than 160/100, always start with a combination of drugs rather than a single drug. The Indian guidelines almost follow the British guidelines that you can start with either an angiotensin converting blocker or a beta blocker, the newer beta blocker, that you have below, or a calcium channel blocker or a diuretic. Then if it is not controlled, you add an extra drug. Go on titrating the first drug to the maximum dose and last 4 to 6 days, if the patient is resistant, add a alpha blocker or a spironolactone. So what it insists basically is that try to exhaust A, B, C, D, and if still there are problems, reserve alpha blocker and spironolactone for the last. This is very important. Now, the value of beta blockers as a first-line agent in hypertension has taken a step back, except in the European people who still promote it, because these were the drugs which used in young hypertensives. Now, another fact about the choice of diuretics, there was a lot of debate between prothiazide and hydrochlorothiazide. It has already been a consensus that prothiazide is better than hydrochlorothiazide, and this is as per the current data that hydrochlorothiazide is possibly not a drug to be used. Diabetes. In beta blockers, 2 studies, the LIFE study and the ASCOP study, clearly showed that atenolol based regimens were totally useless. So, atenolol is only prescribed by a very mass, very good amount of doctors in a peripheral practice, should not be used for hypertension treatment. The newer beta blockers like nebivolol has in fact been recommended as a vasodilative beta blocker as the first line of option for treatment. Because nebivolol is a very safe drug for younger population, it has got a good role in endothelial. It has also almost no adverse effects so far as sexual dysfunction. concern. And lastly, obviously, there is very important to control blood pressure with these drugs. Let us take two important recent trials, the SPRINT and the HOPE-3. What is SPRINT was there? This was a study for non-diabetics. They tried to see two arms in which the one arm, the intensity dropped down the blood pressure to 120, and a standard treatment arm where they tried to drop down to 140. And they tried to see what were the ultimate composite events, MI, ECS, stroke, heart failure, or cardiovascular death. Surprisingly, it was seen that intensive arm, which you see in the yellow graph, the intensive arm had a 25% lower risk of primary outcome. This is a very important data because the SPRINT study has been just published in 2015, and it was said that the numbers needed to prevent one primary outcome as in the 61 patients. So this started giving new ideas about that lower is better, and definitely it was seen that hypotension was not much, acute kidney injury. In fact, if you try to lower it to a particular level less than certain standards, then definitely acute kidney injury could take place. So treatment effects simulated all six specified groups based on age, sex, race, baseline, history of cardiovascular disease, or and kidney disease. The overall benefits of the more intensive blood pressure arm exceeded the potential for harm. So this gives us the message that it is very important to keep the blood pressure low. But one thing that was pointed out in this SPRINT study was that this was a very stringent study that was done in which they took 3 readings, following the standard protocol of keeping a gap of 5 minutes, making the patient comfortable, and if SPRINT is applied without attention to proper BP measurement, substantial over-treatment with a high rate of adverse event problem. So we have to follow the SPRINT guidelines if I have to blood pressure. So suppose if you bring the blood pressure to less than 120 millimeters of mercury in systole, this likely represents the judicious balance between the clinicians to try to approximate to 120 while avoiding side effects of excessive polypharmacy. Now, the clues that we got was that clothalidone is better than hydrochlorothiazide. Amlodipine is a drug of choice, and beta blockers are considered less preventive, especially atenolol, and it is the newer beta blockers that have to be used. After this, the HOPE-3 study came, which was published in 2016 this year, and these patients are intermediate cardiovascular disease patients, and they were tried to also reduce the cardiovascular events by lowering the blood pressure. The same end events were considered, and what is so that the intensive arm and also the one which didn't have an intensive thing are but almost similar. This was a little bit contradictory to what the SPRINT study said, and said that there was no significant difference in myocardial components of the outcomes, total mortality or new onset diabetes. After the HOPE-3 study, the controversy came is that why should we go for so intensive lowering? Because what we see is that if you try to lower it down also versus if you don't lower it down also, it has less than 140, the results are the same. But when a subgroup analysis was done, it was seen that definitely clothalidone, hydrochlorothiazide and candecyclovir was better, and these were the patients where the blood pressure was limited around 140. Now, the emphasis of the HOPE-3 trial is basically on the blood pressure measurement protocol. Are we following the correct protocol of measurement? So nowadays we are emphasizing a lot on that blood pressure measurement should be meticulously done and not left to the paramedic to do so that he does not, he or she does not know it to do it in a proper manner, and finally the outcome is worse. So these findings contradict that lower is better hypothesis. The HOPE-3 data are compatible with the hypothesis that treating persons without cardiovascular disease for systolic blood pressure above 140 appears to be beneficial, but treatment would not be benefit or may even be harmful in persons with lower systolic blood pressure. Based on this, the guidelines have come up now that try to keep the systolic blood pressure 140, do not try to push it a little bit low. But somehow two subsets, that is diabetes and CKD, but the ACCORD BP gave the data of ACCORD was published in 2010, in which they took diabetic patients who had some amount of renal failure, and these patients were randomized, and they saw that the lower arm, the very intensive therapy was given, did better than 140-90 for people less than 60 and 150-90 for people more than 60. If you are diabetic, 140-90, if you are CKD, 140-90. This is in contradiction of the GNC 7-day. The GNC also followed a similar figure, but for diabetics and CKD, the patient is elderly, trying to go still lower. The American Society just copied whatever GNC did. The ACC and AHF, the Heart Association, also tried to do the same to cover all amateur bodies. But the ADO recommendation was that if the patient has albumin layer, try to make it to less than 130 by 80 if there is albumin layer of more than 30 mg per 24 hours. So the ADO study was basically on non-diabetic adults with CKD, but they tried to bring down the patient. Also, there were renal transplant patients, elderly patients. So here the recommendation is to try to lower down the blood pressure a little higher and aim for 130 by 80 if albumin is present. Now, the last controversy that has to be addressed, which many ask, should I take the blood pressure medicine in the morning or at night? Most of the prescriptions you see are written that you take the blood pressure in the morning time. But if you see whatever data we have on today and the studies that are be coming up, they have all recommended that blood pressure medicine should ideally be given in the evening dose. Because if you give it in the evening dose, the chances of heart attack, death, MI, and stroke are less. And this is a study that is a time study, the treatment or monitoring versus evening, which is recruiting more than 10,000 patients and is expected to be completed in 2019, will give us a lot of idea about morning or evening for antihypertensives. The HIGEA trial has clearly stated that the safety profile should be considered, and this trial is to be completed in 2020. So to wait for 3 or 4 more years till we get the data. But whatever it is, if you do a review of all the studies, the fact is that there was no significant difference in overall adverse events of withdrawals. But better blood pressure control is achieved with bedtime dosing. The clinical significance, which is not yet known, we are waiting for the trialing, like the time study and the other studies which will be published in around 2018-2019, we will get more data on this. The actual hypertension is definitely a public health, or public health importance, because in spite of our Western treatments, we do not have hypertension adequately controlled. We should be very particular about measuring the accurate blood pressure, giving a very lot of importance. Ambulatory blood pressure monitoring is an extremely important tool. Although the recent trials have provided useful information on lowering blood pressure further, ease of post blood pressure is recommended by the ACG of the GNC that we follow. BP goals can be lowered further in some special population, especially to diabetes and chronic kidney disease. Choice of drugs has to be individualized. If you see 2 needs a beta blocker first, or 2 needs a calcium channel blocker, or 2 needs a AC inhibitor, but the basic take-home message should be start with the AC inhibitor ARB. If the first BP is more than 160 by 100, add 2 drugs, AC inhibitor ARB with the calcium channel blockers, or the third generation beta blockers. Till more data emerge, evening dosing of antihypertensive should be given. No